But it doesn't look as if we're doing terribly well at the moment, though, Roger, when we have all these things in place.
Listen, Mike, I'm being good citizens about this because I'm an advisor to the Met on police, on race as well, and have been for nearly 20 years.
Right.
There isn't... The white criminals are just as bad. The Irish criminals, what they call ODCs in Ireland, you know, ordinary decent criminals, that they switched from bank robbery to smuggling cigarettes because the penalties were... And so if Priti Patel and Johnson go on and increase the sentences, it won't stop the crime. It'll just stop people being caught, and they will switch to other crimes. The violence between the gangs is just to do with, you know, pride and vengeance and all sorts of things.
Well, then let's move on to what appears to be a new development, though, and it certainly at the moment is the focus of an awful lot of people's attention, and that is the knife crime epidemic. And we're learning this morning from a story in the Times that an awful lot of people, kids, young kids, are being recruited in what they're calling chicken shop gangs, basically, kids who are excluded from school are going into these chicken takeaway shops and being sort of lured into criminality. That would appear to be an increase and a more modern way of doing these things, right?
Well, I don't think that is a more modern way. It's been happening since the gangs on the streets in London would just capture people, and sometimes it was called the army, and these were kids who were just literally taken off on their way home to bring bread to their mothers. I mean, the vulnerability of young kids, either by attraction or by force, to being in gangs is definite problem, and the shortage of youth workers and youth centres that has come up recently. I mean, thousands of these places have been cut.
We hear about this all the time.
That is seriously linked to the epidemic that you're talking about.
Okay, but Roger, you can't have it both ways. You can't tell me that it's the same as it's always been, but it's somehow worse because we don't have youth centres.
I'm talking about the prevention elements. I'm not saying it's worse because, and Mike, the numbers are a numbers game. There's the people actually at the crime, the amount of people who get caught, the amount of people who get prosecuted, and the amount of people who get punished, all of that is dependent on sort of short elements. What I'm talking about are the real drivers of why a young person would carry a weapon or get into crime. And I'm saying that is the classic sense of being vulnerable, that you need the weapon to protect yourself, and that the gang will say, we'll give you money you couldn't earn any other way and protect you. And that is why we need to intervene in that intricacy.
Yes. So you would accept that is different and that is a new development, and therefore we now have a problem which is not the same as it's always been, because this one is a new problem which is being created by a need for people to carry knives for whatever reason and a need for more people to stab each other for whatever reason.
Well, it isn't a need for more people to catch us, to stab each other. What I'm saying is, I mean, I spent nearly 2 years with a bunch of young offenders, and I watched the thing that drove them to violence would be digging. They wanted their dignity. They didn't like being dissed. You know, that's disrespected. And they would risk going to prison. The penalties meant nothing to them at that moment. So I'm not saying it's not a new problem as such. It's just simply an old problem that's got new clothes on, if you like.
And yes.
Social media as well. Social media threats have drastically increased the sense of fear among young people. It's really tough to be a teenager now.
I am a paid-up supporter of the Brexit Party.
Okay.
And I was absolutely flabbergasted that Nigel Farage, our leader and a real hope for Brexit, had to bring the royal family into a discussion that he had in Australia and on Sky.
Yes.
He is inadvertently, in my opinion, done some damage to the Brexit Party, because I would suggest that over 50% of those supporting the Brexit Party will be royalists.
Yes.
We didn't need to know that the Queen Mother liked a glass of gin and she smoked.
But it wasn't a great secret, though, was it? I mean, it's interesting you bring this up, Malcolm, because I was talking to someone yesterday afternoon about this, because the story broke after I left the studio here. And I wondered whether people in the Brexit Party would think badly of Nigel for saying these things.
Well, for me personally, I was awarded the MBE, and I met the Queen.
Right.
And fantastic lady. He didn't need to say anything. He certainly didn't need to tell us about Harry being at the top of the tree, and now he's fallen many, many branches towards the bottom.
Yeah.
We knew that. We don't need to be told that. He needs to be careful what he's saying, because there are the media, 98% of the media is out to get him.
Right. And do you think it's these are the sorts of things that are, it's a bit like a family. It's all right to say them inside the family, but you certainly don't say them outside the family. You don't say them when you're abroad on a speaking tour.
When you are a leader of a national party that is riding high in the polls, and you then are facing a prime minister that is actually doing everything that people want to see being done in this country, you don't hand the opposition a golden gun to shoot you with. And that's what he's, in my opinion, that's what he's done. He should not have brought the royal family into it.
I mean, come on, what a joke this is. I'm a one-man band taxi driver, right?
Yeah.
And if, I'm sure there are thousands of others just like me, and that's just my industry. If they were to enforce this, we would all be off the road and on benefits.
Yes. So, well, here's another question for you, Simon. How would they enforce it anyway? What are they going to do? I saw your lips move as you drove past the police car.
The only way I reckon that they would do it, they would obviously team up with the licensing bodies at the councils.
Yeah.
And rely on customers to complain.
Right.
But, you know, the thing is, I have been doing this job many, many years, and there are far greater risks than talking to someone on a hands-free.
Yes.
I mean... Yeah. Where do you draw the line? Do we not pick up unpredictable drunk people anymore? Because they, you know, I mean, I've got it on quite good authority, seeing as I spent 10 years as a bus driver, that elderly people fall over on buses. Do we not pick up elderly people anymore?
Yes.
I mean, where does it end?
I think we live in a world now where everybody expects everything to be perfect. They're trying to make it perfect. Well, guess what? It ain't perfect, and you can't make it perfect.
No, the problem is that there are plonkers out there on the road, right? Now, how many times do you see somebody at night that's driving along with their sat-nav right in their vision with the brightness up full? Now, that person needs pulling to one side and explaining to them in very simple terms, you cannot do that.
No.
Right? Let's concentrate on people that are actually getting it wrong. Instead of actually punishing everybody.
Yes.
Let's actually get the police out there, because that's what Boris has promised. Pull these people over, and I don't care, even if it's fog lights on a dry day or evening, if they've got something wrong, pull them, crack down on everything, and then that's one way of sorting things out.
So if you imagine that her front paws are there and you're literally just grasping the hind legs and holding it, you're just letting gravity help.
Yeah, okay.
That's all you're doing. Nothing more exciting than that,
right.
But it can.
And will the dog be sort of flapping around at this point? Or probably not, right, if they're not able
It depends
to
at what point you've got to them.
Yeah.
They're usually quite grateful that you're doing something to help them, because they're scared.
Yeah, of course.
Just like any human choking would be.
Yeah, all right.
Right, if that hasn't helped,
right.
Your second
So simply treatment, just the act of holding sometimes is enough.
Yeah, upside down.
A little bit of
gravity.
Shaking.
Gentle.
Not gentle.
Gentle, let's not give it brain damage whilst we're
not
trying
like
to save
it. Not like that scene in Men in Black, you know, where he's trying to get him to say where the thing is, you know.
Okay. Let's not try and do any harm. So
literally,
you know, see, sometimes that's all it takes.
Okay.
And then you can maybe see it, and then you can remove it.
Right.
Right, second line treatment, you're going to put your arm over the top.
Over the top here?
No, so if you put... Hold on, if I...
Yeah, you can show me.
Okay. What I want you to do is to put your hand underneath, make a fist like that with one hand, put it under here like that, and with the other hand you're going to pull in and up like a J.
Okay, so that's sort of like the Heimlich.
Right, it is the Heimlich for dogs.
Thing. So one hand there, one like
make
there.
Make a fist like that, the other hand over the top, over the top of your hand underneath.
Oh, sorry.
And somehow, by supporting, you're going to pull in and under.
Okay, so kind of...
Let me just hold him here.
It feels like he's... Yeah, okay. So
no,
it feels
like... Okay, now, in and under.
So in and under, like that.
Harder.
So how is he...
Like that. So right down there. Now pull in and hard. The J-shaped movements.
Oh, like that.
There we go. Fantastic.
Something came out of his mouth.
No,
it came out.
Yeah, well, it would have come out of his mouth, absolutely, in real life. So that's
brilliant.
What your choking aid does.
Great
to...
success. I see. No, it's good though that you show me, because once you've done it,
in and up,
right.
And it's the same on a human.
Right.
That in and up, and if that hasn't helped, you're then going to go upside down, and then go back, do up to five of those, and you'd be ready to do CPR.
This May and Hammond situation, it reminds me a little bit like the perils of Penelope Pitstop, the cartoon I grew up with, because, you know, you had Sylvester Sneakley on the one hand pretending to be Penelope's protector, and yes, on the other hand, he was really the hooded claw.
Right, well, absolutely. Well, I mean, it's not ridiculous to actually make these analogies, I have to tell you.
No, and of course, you know, we all believed, as I did when I voted for May, that, you know, she was there to represent the United Kingdom's interest in Europe, when actually her and her cabinet were representing the European Union's interests in the United Kingdom.
Well, you can very plainly see, Andrew, since Boris Johnson's got in, how much work he's managed to get through. He's done more in 3 weeks than she did in 3 years.
He certainly has. I mean, I voted for the Brexit Party at the European elections in order to get rid of May, and I will happily, because I've been a lifelong Conservative, I will happily return to the Conservative fold, providing that Brexit is delivered on the date he said it's delivered.
Yes.
If not, then I and millions like me will abandon the Conservatives forever, and I suspect that Boris knows that.
Yes. I think he is very determined to get it done. I think he, for his own personal reasons, wants it done. And I think, basically, it will happen. But, yes, we are going to see an awful lot of moaning and groaning and whining from people like Burko, people like Philip Hammond, and probably even other people in the Tory party. We know Dominic Grieve isn't really a Tory anymore. You know, Philip Lee's not really a Tory. All of these people who want to remain in the European Union are basically trying to ignore the people who voted to leave it.
Well, indeed, and I think the most egregious argument that they've come up with is somehow that Brexit, whether it's deal or no deal, will miraculously lead to the breakup of the United Kingdom. I mean, one of the biggest mistakes that Brexiteers have made is that they've allowed Remainers to completely control the language and the narrative. And
yes,
so one of the most false of those narratives is the idea that, you know, Scotland voted Remain or London voted Remain. We didn't. This was a UK-wide vote. One vote in Glasgow at exactly the same weight as one vote in Glenavy, one vote in Gower and one vote in Gloucester. You cannot regionalise a plebiscite that's conducted when the United Kingdom was and is the member state. So that's one lie that they've been allowed to get away with. And, of course, the second lie is that if you look at the elections to the Scottish Parliament, even when the SNP won a majority of seats in 2011, no secessionist bloc has ever won more than 50% of the votes for that Parliament.
Of course,
and of course they lost.
It's also true to say, Andrew, that more people voted to leave the European Union in Scotland than have ever voted for the Scottish National Party in one fell swoop.
Indeed, and the same in Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
You know, more voted to leave than voted for Sinn Féin and the SDLP combined. And interestingly, had everyone in Scotland and Northern Ireland voted Remain, the United Kingdom's overall result would have been to Remain.
Exactly,
I
right.
I would have accepted that.
Exactly right. We would have accepted. That is the crucial point.
Well, I think what we're seeing here is in Brexit's darkest hour, if you like, you're shining a true light on the inner machinations of the governmental machine, which is uniting in its full fury to delay and block Brexit. And this is the truth. We have a situation now where people like Hammond, and especially people like Burko, do not see themselves as our servants, but instead as our masters. And I find it particularly galling that spreadsheet Phil refers to the fact that nobody voted for a no deal when, you know, David Cameron was on television repeatedly, and the government's own white paper stated with absolute clarity that if we could not achieve a deal, we would go to a WTO Brexit. That's the definition of a no-deal Brexit. It was there as plain as the nose on his face, yet, of course, he's choosing to ignore that because it doesn't fit the script now.
The thought of a Marxist who actually hates our royal family and hates our country and is friends with our enemies going to the palace, I mean, that, you know, have we got this far? My God. What we've written, also the amount of people on all forms of radio at the moment saying nobody voted for no deal.
It's not true.
There are literally hours worth of footage of people, Hammond and Grieve, I've seen it, I've sat and watched it, of them saying if we don't have a deal, we will leave without a deal. It's online. It's there to be seen with your own eyes and ears. Yet now, no one voted for that. It's not true, Mike. And I think we're very close to a revolution. It won't happen yet. But if a legitimate and true vote is denied, I think at some point we might see a revolt in this country. We're not very good at revolt in Britain, but I'll tell you what, it's coming.
Well, it's almost like, you know, how much more of this nonsense are we expected to put up with? How much more crazy behaviour can these MPs get away with?
I just want to know what's in it for them. Why are they so in love with Europe when the people aren't? You know, I can see a point where a million people march on Parliament and actually take it over. And just, you know, all the Hammonds and your Greaves, they're taken to Traitor's Gate down the Thames because we need to have some resolution. We want to leave. We all voted to get out of the customs union and the single market. The reason the EU want to keep us closely aligned to the customs market and the single market and the customs union is because a future government could come in and it makes it easier for them to get us back into Europe. Does that make sense, Mike?
Yeah, it does. Because I don't. What I can't understand is how much longer. I think they're in the kind of death throes, some of these MPs, because they know that this is their final throw of the dice, that they know as soon as there's a general election, an awful lot of them are going to be out of a job. Sarah Wollaston for one, Dominic Green probably for two, and all sorts of other people who have betrayed their constituents. And they know that this is really their kind of final last chance saloon drink, and that's why they're playing up so much. And they are absolutely getting as close to breaking point for me in terms of our, you know, confidence in them as they can get. As far as the future goes, and as far as the makeup of Parliament goes, it doesn't seem to me that anybody can stop what it is that Boris Johnson wants to do. And I'm now more and more convinced that, you know, it is going to be a no-deal Brexit because there isn't anybody else who can sort that out.
No, we would have known by now. If they had anything in terms of planning, the Remain MPs and Burko, we would have known they would have announced it somehow, they would have planned it. But because they're going completely with no confidence planning, that means they've got nothing up their sleeve.
Right. There is this weird court case, which we haven't really examined properly, which has been launched in Scotland, only because apparently the Scottish courts stay open during the summer.
Yeah.
And so they've filed a sort of submission there, and there's going to be some kind of hearing on September the 6th, right?
But it's still timing. They don't have the timing behind them. So by the time that finishes, we've left. So.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's basically they've been stitched up like kippers, which is quite amusing to watch. And also what is very funny to watch for me is the kind of hysterical Remainers who are just literally, they don't know what to do. No. They're flapping around almost as if they know the game is done, and they're just going to have to try and keep making as much noise as possible to seem relevant. But they don't seem very relevant anymore.
No, I'm going to miss them, but you know.
Yeah. Oh, well, you know, perhaps we'll see them again at the next time there is a referendum. We shall see.
The truth is the matter, she is being very badly exploited, and just as, you know, people like you and I will get annoyed with her for telling us what to do, in reality, she is a poster girl for a campaign that you know, is really pretty nasty and pretty obnoxious and is pretty determined to force us to change our ways in ways that they're not going to. But I actually think, Mike, potentially she is a victim within all this. She is someone who's been badly exploited. I mean, 2 weeks on a boat, age 16, she's got Asperger's, she's had mental health problems in the past with two blokes she doesn't know. Now, I'm not casting aspersions on these guys, but would you send your 16-year-old daughter on a two-week Atlantic boat trip when she has no knowledge of sailing whatsoever and she has multiple mental health problems? Of course you wouldn't.
Well, you wouldn't. And her father, I suppose, in fairness to him, is on the voyage with her, so I presume he'll be there to look after her. But certainly people have said it's a bit odd for a young female girl, a teenager, to be on a boat with four guys, you know, even though one of them is, in fact, her father. I think the other problem we've got here is that she's now said, rather boldly, that she's refusing to meet up with Donald Trump, despite the fact he's the President of the United States of America and might be the most influential man when it comes to climate change. If you could win him over, why wouldn't she want to do that? And it tells you everything you need to know about the sort of political motivation of these people.
Well, her team have previously expelled journalists from press conferences on the grounds they didn't like the questions.
Yeah.
Look, you know, we've got to separate out two things. As I say, if you are lucky enough to have very wealthy parents who can afford, you know, to hire a, I don't know, £100,000 boat and a crew to sail you around, fine, get on with it. But actually, what she is trying to do is tell the little people that they can't fly. Your introduction, Mike, was absolutely right. What they want to do as a movement, admittedly not Greta herself, but as a movement, they want their private jets, they want their yachts, they want butlers for their butlers, and then little people like you and I can't jump on a Ryanair or EasyJet flight, because we've taxed them out of oblivion. It's completely unfair.
And the charity sector has grown exponentially, I would say, in the last 20 years. It is now a massive business and has always been not a massive business before that. You know, charity used to be something you did in order to do good. It didn't need, it wasn't a place you went to make a fortune. It wasn't a place you went to make a lot of money. It was a place where you went to do good. That seems to have disappeared. There may be people who now volunteer in charitable organisations and who go and work as aid workers in places like the Congo or places like Haiti. But the people who are running these charities are not doing it out of the goodness of their hearts. They're making a fortune.
Well, not many people are making a fortune working
in
charities.
Well, this guy is.
Well, he, as I said, he's the eighth highest paid person in the charity sector. He's a complete outlier.
Yeah, but I remember, Ian, from last year's investigation into Oxfam that the Times did, that there were many people working for Oxfam who were paid in excess of $200,000 a year, a lot of them.
There weren't many people who were paid in excess of £200,000 a year. There's only a small number of people in the charity sector that are paid in excess of £200,000. I mean, it's not... Their idea that people are earning hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of pounds is just not true. So we can discuss the levels of pay, but the idea that, you know, as I said, he's the £435,000 is the eighth highest paid charity sector salary. There's a handful of people that earn £250,000. Again, they're mainly at places like, you know, health organisations and trusts and things like that. And you mentioned about they're not doing it for the good or they don't have goodness at heart or the values. Yeah, I maintain that they do. But when you work in the charity sector, you've got aspirations. You want to own a house. You want to go on holiday. You want to progress well. And charities have duties of care for the people, not just that they care for their beneficiaries, but the people who work for them. And they've got to be good employers. They've got to be decent employers, and they've got to treat them well.
No, I get all that. Well, I'm not saying that they don't have goodness in their hearts. I'm not suggesting that they're all evil, horrible kind of, you know, Bond villains. All I'm saying is that clearly it's not only goodness that is motivating them, because clearly it is a very high-paying job and it's a very well-paid job. And if you can get high enough up the tree in the charitable sector, you will do very well for yourself. Thank you very much. And all I'm saying is I don't think charities are meant to be run like that.